Hello, General Chemistry. Welcome to a quick review of significant figures. Now, I fully expect most of you are pretty comfortable with significant figures from your work in physics last year. However, I wanted to take this opportunity to make sure that you get a quick reminder of the rules for counting significant figures in different measurements. And then we'll very briefly point out how we calculate the number of significant figures when we're going through different mathematical operations. So we'll start by going through the six rules and finish up with those operations. So the first rule when counting significant figures in a measurement is that all non-zero numbers are significant. And as we go through this little discussion, we will kind of build upon this. So I don't want to get too far ahead as we're going through the early rules. But in these two examples, for 1,337, all four of those non-zero digits are significant. In the number 1.42, those are all three non-zero numbers and are therefore significant. The second rule is that zeros appearing between non-zero digits are significant. So here we have a couple of examples where in the number 6,309, there are some non-zero digits, and then there's an additional non-zero digit at the end, which causes that middle zero to be significant. Many of the next rules we're going to talk about are actually going to be focused on zeros because that's where it can get a little bit tricky. But if the zero is in a sandwich between non-zero numbers, then it does make it significant. So in both of the examples that I have here, the zeros in the middle are significant. Rule number three states that leftmost zeros appearing in front of non-zero digits are not significant. You can really think of these as placeholders. So they are showing us where the measurement starts with significance. So here we have 0.00086. All four of those leftmost zeros are not significant. And then we don't normally write numbers like my second example, but I just wanted to be thorough here. So again, there are four zeros before the number 432. In both of these cases, these leftmost zeros appearing in front of non-zero digits are not significant. What I really recommend doing in situations like this is using scientific notation. So we can really express the correct number of significant figures very quickly by writing measurements in scientific notation where appropriate. Rule number four states zeros to the right of a number after the decimal place are significant. So now we're dealing with the end of a number. And if there is a zero at the end of a number and it's after the decimal place, those zeros are significant. So if we look at 83.50, this could be a mass measurement that we take in class. And a habit that I want to see you all get into is being sure to record the zero at the end of this, right? That zero matters. It is significant. It's giving us information about the precision of the instrument we've chosen to use to take a measurement. So if it's a zero at the right of a number, after the decimal place, it is significant. So all four of the digits in 83.50 are significant. For the second example here, 0.04520, the leftmost digits, if you recall rule number three, are not significant. And the rightmost digit is significant because it's at the end of the number after the zero. Rule five states zeros at the rightmost of a number to the left of an implied decimal point are not significant. So the number 3000. Hopefully you can make some connections back to the measurement activity we've been working on, but there is only one significant figure in the number 3000. The other three zeros, so the three is significant, it's a non-zero digit. The other three zeros are placeholders. They're telling us that we have three as a significant digit, but we have three sets of 1000, yes? The other zeros in this number are just placeholders, showing us what magnitude that significant figure has. Also, 2020. So the two non-zero digits, the twos, are significant. The first zero is also significant because it is in between two non-zero digits. But the last zero, again, according to rule five, is a non-significant digit. It is a placeholder. And finally, rule six. And rule six is kind of interesting. I think it's the rule that tricks students up most often. And it has to do with counted numbers. So, and defined, counted and defined numbers. So a counted number has unlimited significant figures. For example, let's say there are 12 students in our class. We never have more or less than a whole student. All right, so if we count 1, 2, 3, et cetera, up to 12, there are precisely 12 students. We never have 11.78 students or 12.01 students. All right, there are always exactly 12 in that example. The second case here is when we have a concept that is defined with a number. So there are 60 seconds in 1 minute. A minute is defined as having exactly 60 seconds. So in this case, the number 60 has unlimited significant figures. There are not 60.02 seconds in a minute or 59.5 seconds in a minute. Keep an eye out for this one. It actually comes up quite a lot in chemistry for us. Finally, calculations. And you're going to have an opportunity to practice these, and I'll provide some guidance, but I tried to really just break them down into their fundamental components. We're actually going to start with the second one on this list, multiplication and division. This is a rule that most students have internalized very effectively. When we multiply and divide with sig figs, the answer is rounded to the same number of significant figures as the value with the fewest sig figs. So you take your starting components, you figure out how many significant figures they each have, or each of them have, and then your final answer is going to have the number of significant figures equal to the number of significant figures in the starting component with the fewest. So that's probably the calculation rule that you already know. When we are adding and subtracting, it gets just a bit more complicated. Instead of counting how many sig figs are in each of the starting components, you need to identify which of the starting components has the fewest number of decimal places, right? So is the least precise in and of itself. Whatever number has the fewest number of decimal places, you are going to round to the same number of that decimal. So if its least precise digit is in the tenths place, you would round your final answer to the tenths place. If you have questions, let me know. Otherwise, we will see you tomorrow.